Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we're studying the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this series, from April to June of 2016, is on the book of Matthew. This particular lesson is the last lesson in that series, so you would guess it's talking about the last little section of the book of Matthew, which it does, for June 25 of 2016. So we hope you have your Bible handy. You won't have to turn it to lots of different places. Most of it's right there. And let's begin with a word of prayer. Our wonderful Father, we wish we could have been there, and someday we hope to see your version of a video or a DVD or whatever it is, showing us in 3D living color exactly what happened through those final events of the life of Jesus. And on that resurrection morning, what a glorious event. What a wonderful thing to have happened. So many things, we just wish we had all day to talk about it. But now Jesus has given us a task, and we need to talk about that as well. And our lesson today is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Resurrection, what does that mean to you? To rise from the dead is a pretty spectacular thing, isn't it? It's the great hope for Christians, right?
Yes.
So in this lesson, we're going to talk about Matthew's recounting of the trial before Pilate, the mockings and the beatings. We're going to go over that pretty fast. The crucifixion, which we've talked a little bit about already in last week's lesson, and the events connected with the resurrection itself. Where was Matthew at the time of the crucifixion?
We don't know.
We have no idea.
They scattered. That's all we know.
Scattered.
My image has always been they were gathered around the cross, and no. I was surprised to learn that those disciples.
There were a few women.
Yeah.
And there was John. Of the followers, those are the ones that were there.
So they scattered after the Last Supper.
They scattered after Gethsemane. From Gethsemane, when the soldiers came, they were gone. So where did he get his information? Did John tell him about the cries of Jesus when he was forsaken by God?
Research.
On the road to Emmaus, maybe he was one of those guys.
I don't think so. Well, let's read a few verses here. I'm looking from Matthew 27, starting with verse 11. Jesus stood before the Roman governor who questioned him. "Are you the king of the Jews?" he asked. "So you say," answered Jesus. But he said nothing in response to the accusations of the chief priests and elders. So he responds to Pilate, at least some of the time, but he absolutely refuses to respond to the chief priests and elders who are making all sorts of accusations against him. So Pilate said to him, "Don't you hear all these things they accuse you of?" But Jesus refused to answer a single word, with the result that the governor was greatly surprised. Reading on, at every Passover festival, the Roman governor was in the habit of setting free any one prisoner the crowd asked for. At that time, there was a well-known prisoner named Jesus Barabbas. So we have Jesus Barabbas, we have Jesus Christ, or Jesus the Messiah, in contrast to each other. So when the crowd gathered, Pilate asked them, "Which one do you want me to set free for you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus called the Messiah?" He knew very well that the Jewish authorities had handed Jesus over to him because they were jealous. While Pilate was sitting in the judgment hall, his wife sent him a message. "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, because in a dream last night I suffered much on account of him." You wonder what that dream was like. The chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask Pilate to set Barabbas free and have Jesus put to death. But Pilate asked the crowd, "Which one of these two do you want me to set free for you?" "Barabbas," they answered. "What then shall I do with Jesus called the Messiah?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they all answered. But Pilate asked, "What crime has he committed?" Then they all started shouting at the top of their voices, "Crucify him." They're not answering his questions. When Pilate saw that it was no use to go on, but that a riot might break out, he took some water, washed his hands in front of the crowd and said, I am not responsible for the death of this man. This is your doing. The whole crowd answered, let the responsibility for his death fall on us and our children. Then Pilate set Barabbas free for them, and after he had Jesus whipped, he handed him over to be crucified.
You know, according to law, Jesus was declared not guilty of anything, right? Mm-hmm. But mob mentality, mob rule, democracy saw to it that he was put to death.
But it also shows Pilate had no spine. Mm-hmm. All he had to do was give an order from a centurion, say, bring 200 troops up here and clean this mess out, but he never even looked like doing it.
It's almost impossible for us as modern Christians to imagine that the crowd, as crazy as they were, standing there before Pilate's judgment hall, could have chosen a common criminal, a murderer, instead of the Lord of glory who could have offered them eternal life. They chose selfishness over love, destruction over salvation, death over life. They fell under the influence of the shouting mob instead of the quiet whispers of the Holy Spirit. Jim, there's your explanation.
There's a statement that goes something like this. People go mad rapidly in crowds, but return to their senses slowly, one by one.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I think the Desire of Ages, the title of the chapter is Not With Outward Show.
Yeah.
And Jesus addressed the issues of you don't win people over in a mob situation. You have to address them individually over time.
Is that kind of like the still small voice that Elijah listened to? Yeah. And
all of those ideas.
Jesus Barabbas was the one who was supposed to be crucified on that middle cross. The name Jesus means Yahweh saves, and Barabbas means son of the Father. So think about it. The one who was
set... was a devil.
Yeah. The one who was set free was entitled Yahweh saves, son of Daddy. Which Jesus would you choose? Here's some interesting thoughts from our Bible study guide. There was Barabbas versus Jesus the Messiah. The Latin name Jesus derives from the Hebrew Joshua, signifying Yahweh as salvation or Yahweh the Deliverer. Barabbas offered political deliverance through human means, aimed armed conflict, political uprisings, civil disobedience. The Messiah tendered spiritual deliverance through spiritual channels, sincere repentance, heartfelt conversion, transformed lifestyles. Barabbas's objective was overthrowing Roman armies and reestablishing Jewish self-government. Christ's objective was overthrowing sinful rebellion and reestablishing God's kingship. Modern Christians encounter similar choices. Some believers think establishing God's kingdom involves party politics, lobbying efforts. This is a great time to talk about party politics, isn't it? And partisan maneuvering. Sometimes their objectives are laudable. Their methodology, however, is forever flawed because Christ seeks willingly obedient hearts rather than legally coerced compliance. The Jesus of these political Christians is Barabbas. Jesus the Nazarene guides the Christians who are authentic believers. Their mission supersedes political change and challenges humankind to experience spiritual transformation. Only this internally motivated conversion can raise humanity above legalistic self-righteousness to experience genuine liberation. Christ's kingdom, he declared, is otherworldly. This Messiah should be our choice. That's from page 173 of the Adult Teacher's Bible Study Guide. This man, Barabbas, this is Ellen White's words, had claimed to be the Messiah. He claimed authority to establish a different order of things, to set the world right. Under satanic delusion, he claimed that whatever he could obtain by theft and robbery was his own. He was trying to be a Robin Hood kind, I guess. He had done wonderful things through satanic agencies. He had gained, so he was directly used by Satan. He had gained a following among the people and excited sedition against the Roman government. Under cover of religious enthusiasm, he was a hardened and desperate villain, bent on rebellion and cruelty. By giving the people a choice between this man and the innocent Savior, Pilate thought to arouse them to a sense of justice. He hoped to gain their sympathy for Jesus in opposition to the priests and rulers. Desire of Ages 733, and of course, he failed. So why do you think the Jewish leaders, and in fact, almost all the rest of the Jews, reject Jesus?
Threaten their power.
He didn't fit their paradigm of what the Messiah should be.
Why do people tend to prefer darkness over light? Spiritually, anyway.
Because their deeds are evil. Yes.
Because their deeds are evil. Can you see any of that kind of thinking in your own behavior or your own experience? How did this tendency toward evil get started? Did it start right in the Garden of Eden with Adam blaming Eve and Eve blaming the snake? Has that tendency grown even stronger through over the years as we continue to sin? Well, look at Matthew 27, 45, and 46. Let's get right to the crucial point here. At noon, the whole country... So when was Jesus crucified? What time in the day?
At 3 in the afternoon.
Not crucified. Crucified.
Oh.
When he was put in, when he was hung up.
Nailed.
Early in the morning, wasn't it?
9 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock in the morning, he was crucified. And all the events we read about people's different things, saying things, whatever like this, happened between 9 and 12. At 12, suddenly there was this absolutely intense blackness. You couldn't see anything. I don't know whether it came on just fairly quickly or just suddenly, I don't know. But there was this intense blackness that lasted up just until just about 3 o'clock. And it was at 3 o'clock that we're going to read about right now. At about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud shout, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why did you abandon me? Some of the people standing there heard him and said, he was calling for Elijah. One of them ran up at once, took a sponge, soaked it on cheap wine, put it on the end of a stick, and tried to make him drink it. But the other said, "Wait, let us see if Elijah is coming to save him." Jesus again gave a loud shout and breathed his last. So he was crucified at 9 o'clock in the morning. The blackness came on at noon. He was dead at 3. So, what happened there?
And this information would largely have been reported by the women that were there and by John,
mm-hmm.
or soldiers or others who were there.
Yeah. Jesus took upon him the results of sin, which come from separation from the source of life, God himself. Read Isaiah 59, 2 and Romans 6. Well, let's take a moment to do that. Isaiah 59, verse 2. It is because of your sins that he doesn't hear you. It is your sins that separate you from God when you try to worship him. Your sins do what? Separate you from God when you try to worship him. And of course, a familiar verse is Romans 6, 23. For sin pays its wage, death. But God's free gift is eternal life in union with Christ Jesus our Lord.
So perhaps it is appropriate in a church service, for example, maybe during the opening prayer or maybe during your prayer as you sit in the pew, to ask to be cleansed,
mm-hmm.
to be cleaned up there so mm-hmm. that you are able to receive the communication that God seeks to provide there.
Absolutely. Until that time, now try to think about the life of Jesus. Everything you know, I'm closing my eyes temporarily. Think about Jesus from the time he's born to this point, 33 years later, he has never been separated from his Father. We live in constant separation from God. We don't even know what it means to be that, have that kind of relationship with God. Then Jesus felt the terrible consequence of the Father's withdrawal, his wrath. What he felt is exactly, and this is from, I'm not going to give you the quote, but this idea is from Ellen White. What he felt is exactly what sinners will feel in the final destruction of sin and sinners. It is called the second death. And here's her words. The wrath of God against sin, the terrible manifestation of his displeasure against because of iniquity, filled the soul of his son with consternation. All his life, Christ had been publishing to a fallen world the good news of the Father's mercy and pardoning love. Salvation for the chief of sinners was his theme. But now, with the terrible weight of guilt he bears, he cannot see the Father's reconciling face. The withdrawal of the divine countenance from the Savior in this hour of supreme anguish pierced his heart with a sorrow that can never be fully understood by man. So great was this agony that his physical pain was hardly felt. Desire of Ages 753, paragraph 1. We talked about that last week, didn't we? What was happening at the cross? In order to understand, or in order to demonstrate, I might add, the terrible and deadly consequences of sin, the Son and the Father agreed before our world was created to show us in this ultimate demonstration what happens when a human being separates from the source of life. Jesus allowed himself to be separated from his Father. That experience was so horrific and terrible that when it came to a conclusion, Jesus died.
We could put Romans 3:25 in there.
Yeah.
Because that his death was to show that God is righteous and to bring his family into a state of atonement. That's what Paul says.
Yeah, exactly. So. Oh, there's lots of wonderful texts we could bring in, but that would be a very good one.
So what died there? On the cross?
Jesus, the human Jesus.
So that component of him, which was his humanity.
Yes, yeah. And maybe we need to make one point very clear here. Jesus did not use his divinity for his personal benefit, or for that matter, for any other purpose during his entire lifetime, from the time he was born until Sunday morning of resurrection. And Sunday morning of resurrection, after he had won the victory in the great controversy, he once again exercised his divine power and rose to life. He said, I have the power to lay down my life, I have the power to take it up again. But everything in between, he lived as a human being to be our example.
So we could raise someone like Lazarus.
Ellen White puts it this way. She says, everything that Jesus did, we could do if we had the same kind of relationship with the Father that he had.
Big if.
A big if? Well, I put it like this. There was no pretending there. There are people, there are a lot of people, many, many, back in the early days of the church, believed that some kind of a power came down from God and just inhabited a human body, and when it came time to be crucified, it escaped again. So he was just pretending to be a human being. There's no pretending going on here. The wrath of God, that is his turning away, is our definition of God's wrath, his turning away and loving disappointment from those who do not want him anyway, thus leaving them to the inevitable and awful consequences of their own rebellious choices. And this was being demonstrated by Jesus. Jesus, of course, was not a sinner, but he agreed to be treated as a sinner to teach us the very important lesson about sin. Why was that necessary? Did the Father require it?
Nope.
Was the Father angry?
Nope. That word wrath, in general, it from the New Testament, isn't that the word orge? Mm-hmm. And the word orge, we could get orgy, mm-hmm. you get wrath, we could get anger, you could get agony, my understanding. Mm-hmm. So God is in his agony is when he sees, and in agony he let his Son go. Mm-hmm. In agony he lets human beings move away from him, yeah. So from his protection, his sphere of protection.
God is very sorry to see us damage ourselves by sin.
Well, that's Jeremiah 7.
Yeah.
Sin is self-destructive.
Yeah.
Sin pays its way. Rome.
I mean, think about you and your children. If you have children, what would you stand by and just sort of watch as you watch your child maybe carving himself up with a knife or something? I mean, try to imagine that. Or a grandchild. Some of us are having fun with grandchildren. What do we mean when we say that our transgressions fell upon him? What does that mean?
Those are some quotes, aren't they, from Isaiah? He was
53?
Yeah, thereabouts, yeah.
Well, not directly.
I mean, well, to say a transgression, but you can't move sins around.
Yeah.
But he came and lived as a human being and suffered agony that goes along with it.
Well, did Jesus pay the price for our sins?
Well, that's a loaded word.
I'm just asking.
Well, he uses the metaphor when he says that the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to mm-hmm. give his life a ransom for many.
Yeah.
So that kind of sets up the dilemma of mm-hmm. who was it paid to. But maybe if we think of death personified as the recipient of that, as in, mm-hmm. Oh, death, where is your victory? Where is your sting, as Paul uses?
Well, does death have any claims against God?
No, but death has claims against us because we have sinned. So we are...
Does God owe anything to the devil?
No.
So you would say it was paid figuratively to death, the price?
Just a suggestion.
Okay. Well, Jesus fully understood what a close relationship to the Father could mean to a human being. We talked about that a moment ago. Losing that relationship was so awful, as we noted above, that when he felt his relationship breaking up because of sin, it caused his death. Certainly, it is beyond the understanding of any human being at this point in history. It was the worst kind of pain. The only solution available to us is to avoid that kind of pain by beholding we become changed. Great Controversy 5:55.
So then the Jews or the Romans did not kill Jesus.
Earlier he said, I lay down my life and I take it up again. You could read into that, hey, you're not even going to get a chance to kill me.
Yeah.
I mean, he wasn't disrespectful to them.
Neither. They wanted to. They tried to. They did everything they could do to kill Jesus. But it wasn't, they didn't. Crucifixion, he didn't die of crucifixion, he died of sin. Unless you want to say it was their sins and also yours and mine that killed him. And what do we mean when we say something like that?
Well, my perception would be, my interpretation would be, sin exists here because of me. Mm-hmm. And because of that, God had to come here and do what he did, to live the life that he did. It was because of my sins existed are what precipitated Jesus to come here and to die.
So these things are a little bit complicated to understand. I thought maybe it'd be good to stop, take a breather for a second, and look at these words from Ellen White. This is from Christ's Optical Lessons to ages 59 and 60. Merely to hear or to read the word is not enough. He who desires to be profited by the scriptures must meditate upon the truth that has been presented to him. By earnest attention and prayerful thought, he must learn the meaning of the words of truth and drink deep of the spirit of the holy oracles. God bids us fill the mind with great thoughts, pure thoughts. He desires us to meditate upon his love and mercy, to study his wonderful work and the great plan of redemption. Then clearer and still clearer will be our perception of truth, higher, holier our desire for purity of heart and clearness of thought. The soul, dwelling in the pure atmosphere of holy thought, will be transformed by communion with God through the study of scriptures. So that's what God wants to do, and that's the reason for all the stuff we've been talking about. God sets it out there and says, see what you can learn from it. Well, look at Matthew 27:49-54. But the others said, wait, let us see if Elijah's come. We've read this already. Jesus again gave a loud cry and breathed his last. Then the curtain hanging, and Matthew is the only one who mentions this. I'm not quite sure why. Then the curtain hanging in the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. I mean, this is a curtain that's like 30 feet high. Try to imagine it. And this is Passover weekend, okay? There must have been thousands of people crowding in to watch the high priest perform the ceremony. And there he is with his knife. He's about ready to sacrifice the lamb. And they're all looking, and there's the holy place and the most holy place in front of them. And all of a sudden, rip.
Well, now, I thought inside that court, only the priests could kind of see that curtain. Are you saying
it can be open.
At this particular time, everybody was there and they...
Sounds like it. The earth shook, the rocks split open, the graves broke open, and many of God's people who had died were raised to life. They left the graves, and after Jesus rose from death, they went into the holy city where many people saw them. When the army officer and the soldiers with him who were watching Jesus saw the earthquake and everything else that happened, they were terrified and said, "He really was the Son of God."
Now, this is a pretty spectacular event for a community to have all these resurrections and this, that, and the other, and these resurrected people running around. Why aren't there any records of that? Mm-hmm. Why aren't there records in the archives someplace in some Roman museum that recounts
Josephus or something like that, right?
Well, at least Josephus. Yeah, this ought to be, this would be on the CBS Evening News all over the country,
the
world.
Maybe for a whole week or so.
Is the CBS Evening News remembered 1,000 years later, 2,000 years later?
Why is there just nothing? Well, something so spectacular. Why is
Let me read. Let me add some spectacular to it, okay? As Christ arose, now he's crucified and now he's arising, he brought from the grave a multitude of captives. The earthquake at his death had rent open their graves, and when he arose, they came forth with him. I wasn't quite sure what the relationship between those two events was until I really studied for this lesson. They were those who had been co-laborers with God and who at the cost of their lives had borne testimony to the truth. Now this sounds like it was martyrs that had been resurrected, isn't it? Now they were to be witnesses for him who had raised them from the dead. During his ministry, Jesus had raised the dead to life. He had raised the son of the widow of Nain and the ruler's daughter and Lazarus. But these were not clothed with immortality. After they were raised, they were still subject to death. But those who came forth from the grave at Christ's resurrection were raised to everlasting life. They ascended with him as trophies of his victory over death and the grave. Desire of Ages 786, paragraph 1 and 2. Going on, the voice that cried from the cross, now this is 787, paragraph 2 in the next page. The voice that cried from the cross, "It is finished," was heard among the dead. It pierced the walls of sepulchres and summoned the sleepers to arise. Thus will it be when the voice of Christ shall be heard from heaven. That voice will penetrate the graves and unbar the tombs, and the dead in Christ shall arise. At the Savior's resurrection, a few graves were opened, but at his second coming, all the precious dead shall hear his voice and shall come forth to glorious immortal life. Desire of Ages 787, paragraph 2.
Well, perhaps just as Jesus only appeared to certain ones and to certain groups as opposed to preaching in the streets, these mm-hmm. people probably also only appeared to certain ones mm-hmm. as opposed to mingling in the crowds and going about.
Now, you were asking about a little bit more about what was going on in the temple. When the loud cry, "It is finished," this is Ellen White again, came from the lips of Christ, the priests were officiating in the temple. It was the hour of the evening sacrifice. The lamb representing Christ had been brought to be slain. Clothed in his significant and beautiful dress, the priest stood with lifted knife, as did Abraham when he was about to slay his son. By the way, where did that happen?
Same place.
With intense interest, the people were looking on, but the earth trembles and quakes, for the Lord himself draws near. With a rending noise, the inner veil of the temple is torn from top to bottom by an unseen hand, throwing open to the gaze of the multitude a place once filled with the presence of God. So however that happened, they could see in there. In this place, the Shekinah had dwelt. Here God had manifested his glory above the mercy seat. No one but the high priest ever lifted the veil separating this apartment from the rest of the temple. He entered in once a year to make an atonement for the sins of the people. But lo, this veil is rent in twain. The most holy place of the early earthly sanctuary is no longer sacred. Desire of Ages 756 and 757.
And of course, the Shekinah has long departed. The ark has been long lost.
Yes.
So what did we see there?
A stone.
Where did you get that?
It's still there.
It is?
Yeah. If you go into that Dome of the Rock temple, it's a mosque primarily for women. That rock is still there.
So they.
So
they just hustled this rock in there for what reason?
No, they didn't hustle the rock in the rock. It's the bedrock that's the top of that mountain.
And if they'd have had the Ark of the Covenant, they would have set it on top of that rock?
Would have been, well, I'm sure when the temple was there, there was probably a floor and there was a nice room and the angels and so forth, but not anymore.
Well, but
at this point in time?
Yeah, when that table tore that thingle down, that curtain into, what was in
there? It was empty.
Did some of the regular parishioners like you and me, other than the priests, think there was something in there?
Probably so.
So when the priest went back in there once a year for the Day of Atonement, everybody else out here was listening to the bells and all of this stuff, and he just went back in there, kind of stood around for a while and came out?
Yeah. Yep, that's true. Nobody knows where that ark has been, is, or was since the time of the Babylonian captivity. It was hidden away by Jeremiah and his friends, and nobody's touched it since.
So what did they think? I mean, that thing was supposed to have a significant part in the purpose of their rituals and so forth. So they were going through all of these rituals and there wasn't anything in there.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if there's a spiritual application.
The Shekinah glory never came down and dedicated that temple. He dedicated the temple and the tent out in the desert. He dedicated Solomon's temple when it was there, clearly. I mean, he came down and filled that temple so full that the priest couldn't even go in there. Moses couldn't go into the tent out in the wilderness, but not this one. Well, I don't know if we're sort of running out of time, but look at Hebrews 8, 1 to 13. I'm not going to read all of it. Let's start with verse 3. Every high priest is Hebrews 8. Every high priest is appointed to present offerings and animal sacrifices to God, and so our high priest must also have something to offer. If he were on earth, he would not be a priest at all. What tribe did he belong to?
Judah.
The tribe of Judah. They were the tribe of the kings, not the tribe of the priests, since there are priests who offer the gifts required by the Jewish law. The work they do as priests is really only a copy and a shadow of what is in heaven. It is the same as it was with Moses. When he was about to build the sacred tent, God said to him, "Be sure to make everything according to the pattern you were shown on the mountain." Now, there are a lot of people who say that the earthly sanctuary is a perfect copy of the temple in heaven. That's not what it actually says. It says it's a copy of the pattern I showed you. We don't know if that pattern is like the heavenly one or not. Okay. Well, what do these verses suggest? If you read on to Hebrews 9 and 10, what does it suggest about the earthly services? These animal sacrifices accomplish essentially nothing, right? He says if they did any good, you wouldn't need to keep offering them, right? So what does the blood of Christ accomplish that the blood of all those animals could not accomplish? Is the blood essentially different?
The blood is a symbol for life, and Paul says, study his life. Jesus says, study his life. And if you understand his life, his teaching, you can have eternal life yourself. That's one way of looking at it.
Is it the blood itself that's significant?
It's a symbol of life.
Or does it have to do more with the meaning of his death, his life and his death? Yeah, absolutely. Paul seems to suggest that the death of Jesus somehow takes away our sins. How does that actually work?
Sin separates us from God, so in Christ we have access once again to the Father. We can behold the light of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. So we can once again behold God to some degree.
There are many Christians who believe that somehow or other God gathers up all our sins and actually places them literally on Jesus. Is that true? Can sins be moved around?
Sins are not an animate object.
But let's think about this. Did he take away our sins at the time of his crucifixion? Wouldn't that be, I mean, that's the time when he paid the price, right?
I think in the sanctuary service, the sins were covered until the Day of Atonement, and then they were blotted out, at least symbolically.
So how does that fit with the death of Christ?
Well, we're covered. Grace allows us to continue to go on and to behold Christ and be changed from one degree of glory to the next. But in the when things in the cleansing of the sanctuary, then things are made new. We are sin is destroyed, and if we cling to it, we will be destroyed too.
Okay. Well, now let me ask another tough question. If he died for our sins...
Because of sin.
Well, but we usually say he died to take away our sins. Did that happen before we even committed the sins? How can you take away sins before they've been committed?
Well, if you can see into the future, then... You know what sins are going to happen.
Well, then there could be a sense of unfolding, you know, like Abraham paid tithe to Melchizedek, Hebrews says. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, was it Melchizedek was, no, that wasn't it. Anyway, someone who is in the loins of the one doing the work, you know, so...
Levi.
The ones who are still alive at the time there are kept alive because of his death, and all the those who come forth from them, as we are thus kept alive also.
Or does Jesus deal with sin in its totality, all aspects of sin at once, by proving that Satan was completely wrong in all his accusations against God, and thus that all of his claims are false? Does the life and death of Jesus demonstrate that sin is always self-destructive?
Yes, and that's a process of teaching. Mm-hmm. Jesus is a teacher, the Father is a teacher. Mm-hmm. The duty of the parent to the children is to teach, educate, not to bail them out of their...
Yeah. Are those who live a Christian life today really to be pitied? You feel like it's a real sacrifice to live a Christian life?
Not so far for most of us, but it could be.
Depends on what you value.
In Paul's day, those who were Christians were always at risk of death at any moment. But today, Christians, I think, live better lives than other people do.
Depends where you live.
Yeah, sure.
Well, you're equating this Christian experience with temporal...
benefits?
Yeah, temporal prosperity of one way or the other, not necessarily even financial, but security and so forth. But when you compare, at least what little knowledge I have, of the Christian awareness of life and the future of life and what life holds for me, and not only in the future for maybe temporal type things one you can experience tangibly, but that relationship that goes on inside, if you're experiencing that, and you compare that to what it appears to me, perhaps Buddhists or animists or other people, my life is far more secure and calm and peaceful and assured, where theirs appears to me to be worried and fretful and...
Yeah. What evidence is there outside of Scripture that Jesus actually existed and died on a cross? After Nero burned a large portion of Rome, he accused Christians of causing the fire. And I quote now, this is a quotation from Tacitus in his Annals, chapter 15, verse 44. And this is what he said. Now remember, this is written from the perspective of a pagan Roman talking about Christians. Nero fastened the guilt of starting the blaze, the blaze in Rome, and inflicted the most exquisite tortures on a class hated for their abominations, called Christians or Christians in his Latin version, by the populace. Christus, from whom the name had its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hands of one of our procurators, Pontius Pilatus, and a most mischievous superstition, thus checked for the moment, again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but even in Rome, where all things hideous and shameful from every part of the world find their center and become popular. So what's he trying to say there? What's the evil that came up? Is it the idea that the Romans killed Jesus, or is it the idea that Jesus rose to life?
Well,
a little hard to say, huh?
The theological doctrines of Christianity, through the theological doctrines of the Roman religion, all out of whack.
Mm-hmm. It was a threat. They don't match too much.
That's right. They were. It was a threat to almost any misperceived religious.
Yeah.
Well, practice. The resurrection would have been most distasteful to them. Not so mm-hmm. much the crucifixion. They would have. Yeah. He got what he deserved. But.
Yeah.
Why would the resurrection have been distasteful?
Because it shouldn't happen.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially if Romans killed that guy and he's supposed to be dead, and now he's walking around. You know, that kind of throws you into a tailspin, doesn't it? Well, Will Durant, some of you have heard that name, wrote a book about Christianity, Roman civilization and Christianity up to 325 AD. On page 557 of that book, he said that a few simple men should, in one generation, have invented so powerful and appealing a personality, so lofty an ethic, and so inspiring a vision of human brotherhood would be a miracle far more incredible than any recorded in the Gospels. After two centuries of higher criticism, the outline of the life, character, and teaching of Jesus of Christ remain reasonably clear and constitute the most fascinating feature in the history of Western man. I like that testimony. Among scholars, there's probably little debate that a historical figure named Jesus lived, was condemned, and was crucified. There would be arguments about some parts of that. But is it really true that a majority, and this is what our Bible study guide says, is it really true that a majority of the world's population recognize that Jesus of Nazareth existed as a historical person?
Well, I'm not sure many people do that anymore.
It's much more likely that the majority of people living in our world today know almost nothing about Jesus. Many of them have never even heard his name. Some have only heard his name or variations of it as curses. The challenging part of the story of Jesus is the resurrection. The idea that someone could be beaten and tortured, then crucified, and only portions or 3 days later rise to life is something absolutely startling. Yet without this belief, namely that the crucified Jesus was also the risen Christ, notice crucified Jesus and the risen Christ, Jesus is his human name, Christ is his anointed divine name, Christianity falls apart, 1 Corinthians 15, 14, and 19.
How is that any more dramatic than the raising of Lazarus or the resurrections that were performed in the Old Testament?
Well, think about it for a moment. When he died, there's this absolute blackness for 3 hours. Then there's this incredible earthquake. Graves are shaken open. When he rises from the dead, a whole bunch of people rise with him, and they're traveling around the city telling, hey, you know what? I lived 500 years ago, and now I've just been resurrected by Jesus. How often has that happened? Not too many times. So we're left with the conclusion. There are only two choices when we are faced with the story of the resurrection of Jesus. Assuming the story is reasonably complete and accurate. It is either a made-up story, some kind of propaganda perpetrated by a few lonely followers of Jesus to try to keep his memory alive, or it is a first-hand account of an absolutely unique event impacting every human being living on this earth.
Well, you had some pretty authoritative witnesses there at the event. You had a government delegation, yes, that was there to, although they were kind of stupefied for a while.
Yeah, well, those soldiers, you know, we haven't had a time to talk about that, but what happened to them? They fell dead. They saw the angel come down. They saw the stone being rolled away, and when Jesus came forth there, and they went out to tell, and they were on wobbly legs. They were out to tell everybody what they had just seen and what happened. They went first to the priests. The priests called them to come to them first, and they said, we'll give you a lot of money to keep this story secret. They went to Pilate, and Pilate says, yeah, okay, let's keep this story secret. Do you think when that contingent of soldiers finally was taken back to Rome, they didn't tell their wives? There's no way you could keep a story like that quiet.
I wouldn't be surprised if there were some there who eventually found their way into Christianity.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, look at Matthew 28, verses 1 to 15. This is an interesting story. After the Sabbath, as Sunday morning was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. Suddenly there was a violent earthquake. That's part of what I was talking about. An angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled the stone away and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothes were white as snow. The guards who were so afraid that they trembled and became like dead men. I don't think you'd...
I like that touch, sat on the stone.
Yeah. Ellen White suggests there were actually two. So two angels that came down. One that rolled the stone away and sat on it. And the other one said, Father, your father calls you. The angel spoke to the women. You must not be afraid, he said. I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. He's been raised, just as he said. Come here and see the place where he was lying. Go quickly now and tell his disciples he has been raised from death. And now he is going to Galilee ahead of you. There you will see him. Remember what I've told you. So they left the tomb in a hurry, afraid and yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them and said, peace be with you. They came up to him, took hold of his feet, and worshipped him. Do not be afraid, Jesus said to them. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. Was that the first time they saw him at Galilee?
No, probably in the upper room.
Yeah. Yeah, the next day. Well, in fact, that same day. At the end of that same day, they were going to see him in the upper room, weren't they? While the women went on their way, some of the soldiers guarding the tomb went back to the city and told the chief priests everything that had happened. The chief priests met with the elders and made their plan. They gave a large sum of money to the soldiers and said, you are to say that his disciples came during the night and stole his body while you were asleep. Now, think about that story. That's as self-contradictory as you could possibly imagine. How would they know if the disciples came and stole his body away? Remember, this is a sealed tomb. Came and stole their body away while they're sleeping. First of all, they're not supposed to be sleeping. It was a criminal offense punishable by death to be sleeping on duty. They were not supposed to be sleeping. And then if they were sleeping, how would they know that the disciples came and stole the body away? It's self-contradictory. And if the governor should hear of this, we will convince him that you're innocent and you will have nothing to worry about. The guards took the money, did what they were told to do, and so that is the report spread around the Jews to this very day. Notice it doesn't talk about the Romans, it says spread around the Jews. The 11 disciples went to the hill in Galilee where Jesus had told them to go, and of course there Jesus met with them. So, How do you understand the experience of those women? When we compare the other Gospels, we discover that the disciples did not believe their words. What are we supposed to learn from that? Myra, this is your chance.
They wouldn't believe it even after there were two witnesses that saw it.
Yeah.
So one of the reasons they weren't there to see it was that they didn't have enough belief to believe something like that. Those who have beliefs are given the gifts of the experience.
It's interesting that Jesus said, go to the disciples and Peter. Why did he say that?
Probably because of the experience that Peter had there just before when he was on trial, Jesus on trial.
Yeah,
Peter probably probably felt he was disenfranchised and wasn't worthy or entitled or a failure.
Well, and then the last words in Matthew, Matthew 28:16-20. The 11 disciples went to the hill in Galilee where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, even though some of them doubted. Now, elsewhere we're told there was a group of up to 500, so it wasn't just the 11. Jesus drew near and said to them, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Go then to all peoples everywhere and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you, and I will be with you always to the end of the age. So what authority was Jesus given? And how did that work? Nobody sure?
Well, I think God would have given him the authority. And when I read this, I can't help but wonder, how come their friends, the Catholics, go the other way when it's quite plain there that Christ says he is it?
Yeah.
It's got to be in their Bible.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I read again, and I'm sorry for bringing all these passages from Ellen White, but she spells it out so well. The Savior's commission to the disciples, what was the commission?
Go therefore and teach all nations.
Go and teach all nations, right? The Savior's commission to the disciples included all the believers. It includes all believers in Christ to the end of time. It is a fatal mistake to suppose that the work of saving souls depends alone on the ordained minister. All to whom the heavenly inspiration has come are put in trust with the gospel. All who receive the life of Christ are ordained to work for the salvation of their fellow men. For this work, the church was established, and all who take upon themselves its sacred vows are thereby pledged to be co-workers with Christ. Desire of Ages 8:22. What does Jesus intend for us to do if every one of us is supposed to be his co-worker? Jay, have you been out doing any miracles lately?
Well, not the kind that you're talking about.
Okay.
Not the kind.
Didn't mean to put you on the spot there, like, but you know. So in what way are we supposed to be like Jesus?
Well, that's the real miracle.
Well, he went around about doing good. So there's a baseline of whatever is good. We can certainly participate, you know, in whatever.
Well, but
whatever is around us, you know, what opportunities present themselves to us.
We're supposed to be using the talents he gave us.
Okay.
Well, you said that if we were what we ought to be, that Ellen White said if we were what we'd be, then we could do everything that Jesus did. So.
If you had a few people around like that, do you suppose the end would come quicker?
Well, Ken, you need to get on the ball.
Why do you suppose that none of the gospel writers dedicated any significant space to discussing the meaning of the cross? We asked that question earlier. Paul made a brief attempt in Romans 3. It's probably the best in the Bible. It's very good, actually. But those verses have also been misunderstood. What does the resurrection of Christ mean to you personally? If the disciples knew that Jesus was not really raised and they were just perpetrating a lie, don't you think at least one of them would have spilled the beans, as we say, and admitted the truth before he died? When discussing the death of Jesus, many Christians apply the term substitutionary. What does substitutionary mean when referring to the death of Jesus?
Well, that he died the death that I was supposed to die. It took my place.
He took my place, okay. How did the death of, well, how did Christ's resurrection qualify him for all with all authority we talked about? Would you agree that by winning the great controversy, Jesus Christ has earned the right to be crowned as king forever and ever? Remember Philippians 2? Amen. How are we supposed to be involved in finishing the great controversy? And I quote, "It is a privilege of every Christian not only to look for, but to hasten the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ," 2 Peter 3:12 margin.
How do you do that? How do you make things, how do you speed things up?
"We're all," here's her comment, "we're all who profess his name bearing fruit to his glory. How quickly the whole world would be sown with the seed of the gospel. Quickly the last great harvest would be ripened and Christ would come to gain, to gather the precious grain." Christ's Obelisk 69, paragraph 2. The Bible makes it clear that Christ died for our sins. Who all is involved there? Are we in any way responsible for the fact that Jesus was forsaken by the Father?
How much am I supposed to hasten things?
How
much success am I supposed to have? If I don't accomplish that end, have I not been successful?
Well, what I could say is I know that 11 disciples and their friends turned the world upside down in about 30 years.
But they didn't. It didn't come.
He didn't come. That's true. Well, we're running out of time. Without a doubt, the most important portion of Scripture is that dealing with the life and death of Jesus Christ. So what can we do to make it more meaningful in our own lives? It would be well for us to spend a thoughtful hour every day contemplating the life of Christ. We've talked about this before. In order to understand something of the meaning of Christ's death, we must realize that he had to experience the results of sin in order to demonstrate the truth of God's words spoken back in the Garden of Eden. Sin leads to death. Do we really believe that each time we're tempted to sin? Our kind and wonderful Father, we come now at the end of a lesson in which we discuss probably the most momentous events in the history of our world. Help us to carry the messages with us, to share them with others as we have opportunity, and especially to represent you correctly as we can, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.